In this video, we're going to show how to connect the Pi UFL interface to the Pi server. So I've loaded my Pi UFL interface. I've even built a whole configuration file using UFL Designer that tells the interface how to read this text file right here. And in this text file, there's a Pi tag name, there's a timestamp, and there's a value. And the idea is that the Pi UFL interface will read all this data and send it to Pi and write it to the Pi archive. And if this tag here doesn't exist on the Pi server, I want it to create that tag. And in this video, we're going to show how to set up the security so that the Pi UFL interface is able to do that with the Pi server. So to begin with, I'm going to go to my Pi server. So I have a remote connection here to my Pi server. And I'm going to open up System Management Tools, Pi System Management Tools. And I'll go to Security. And to start with, in database security, you can see all the different types of security access we can give users or interfaces or entities. And there's a lot of this that isn't necessary. So for example, for an interface, we don't necessarily want to give an interface permission to create and delete archives, or permission to the audit database, or really this one, permission to some of the security settings. We don't necessarily want interfaces to have all that much access. We want to give them just enough access because that's what's responsible. So next, go to Identities, Users, and Groups, and let's create a new identity for our interface. And this is the kind of the badge that will be given to the interface upon logging in, and it will grant the interface all the rights it needs. So right-click, New Identity, and we'll say Pi Interfaces, and the description will be an identity for to write data and create tags. So I want any interfaces with this identity to be able to actually create new Pi tags. There we go. So now the next step is we want to actually assign this Pi interface's identity some permissions, because right now it doesn't have any. If you go back to database security, notice Pi interface is not on this list at all, so it has no permissions. So what's appropriate is we need to add it to a few of these databases. So start by double-clicking on Pi DS. This is the digital states table. So if we have a tag that has a digital states like on, off, or red, yellow, green, this allows Pi interfaces to use that table. Next we want to do the message log. And the Pi Point database. This allows the interface to write to Pi Points. And then lastly, we want to add access to modules, so the module database. Yeah, and we get this error. And what it's saying is to add this identity to the database security for Pi modules, well, it requires that that Pi identity have at least one mapped Windows user. So what we can do is we need to actually go back to our identities, users, and groups and map a Windows user to this Pi interface's identity. This allows it to sync with the AF server. So we want to have whichever user we add here have access to sync with the AF server. Now I'm just going to add the local administrator. So from pipes, administrator. Oops, you can just search for it here. There it is, pipes the administrator. And I'll say OK, OK. And now, when I go into database security, I can add Pi interfaces, and I'll be allowed to. And so now you can see Pi interfaces is given four different database securities, right there, there, and there. Now the next step is, okay, so now that we've created this new identity, this has all the permissions we need for UFL to be able to do what it needs to do. But when UFL connects, we need to know some way of knowing that UFL is connecting and to give it this Pi identity, to give it this set of credentials, this badge with those permissions. So to do that, we need to click on Mappings and Trusts, and now we'll create a trust to take any incoming connection from PI/UFL and give it PI interfaces the identity. So once we're in trusts, we're going to create a number of different trusts because PI/UFL could connect in a number of different ways. So the first new trust we're going to create, and you can get into this by either right-clicking new trust or going to advanced. We're going to say this is for PI/UFL, and it's for PI, UE, and then IP address. It's a name. Now, PI/UFL can have two different names when it's incoming. One is PI/UE, and one is PI/UFL.exe, and we'll talk more about that in a minute. But this is for PI/UFL interface. This is specifically for the API connection with an IP address. And the IP address of my machine is 10.32.128.84. And you can fill out the rest of these with 255.255. Now, application name, that's where we put PI_UE. And PI identity, you guessed it, we're just going to put PI interfaces, just like that. And now we have our trust. Now we need to create a few other trusts because PI/UFL might connect in different ways. So to do that, the easy way, just copy it, and you'll get a whole other configuration pane already filled out. And we're going to start by, let's say here, we want to keep the IP address, and this time we're going to change it to PI/UFL.exe. And this one's actually the SDK trust. And you're going to change this down here to PI/UFL. And again, then we're just going to copy this trust again. And this time, we're going to do, instead of IP address, we're going to say network name. Because PI/UFL might get identified based on the name of the machine that's incoming. So network name. So we come down here, and this time we're going to clear out the IP address because we're not actually filtering based on that. And we're going to type in the network name. And my network name is scollins6430.osisoft.int. And this application name can stay the same, and the PI identity can stay the same. There we go. And we got a network name. And again, we can copy that. And this time it's going to be PI/UFL.exe/SDK, and we're going to change the application name here to PI/UFL.exe, and we have our four trusts. Look at that. Okay, so we have four trusts, and these are each just filtering different types of connections. We find that different PI systems and different domains and different network settings will have connections come in different ways. And so you just want to build all these trusts so that you're sure that it's going to be able to connect while still staying secure. So you have the application name right here, and then we either have an IP address or we have a network path name. So each of these trusts has two specifications. One, two. That's called a 2+ trust in PI system speak. Okay, so now we have all of our trusts enabled and we can get ready to go. So now I'm going to actually switch to my interface and I'll press play. First I'm going to show two logs. So you can click those two buttons right up top and you'll be able to see what's happening with the PI/UFL interface as it connects. Now for educational purposes, I'm going to start with what if I didn't actually connect any of these. So if I were to disable all of these trusts and try to connect, what would happen? Just because this might be happening to you, and in which case I'll show you the difference between the two. So all the trusts are actually disabled, and now when I come into my PI/UFL interface, if I press play, what's going to happen? So first off, I'm going to run some message logs. So I've started my interface, and we can see different messages coming in. This is from the interface side, what it's reading out or saying. It reads the .any file, for instance. And if I go to my Pi interface, or to my Pi server, and if I go to operations, and then message logs, and then search for message logs that recently happened, I can see, okay, here, very recently, a connection that came in for Pi UE, but no trust is established for this connection. So there was no permissions given. So that interface would not be able to write data at all. So it's a good thing we do have those trusts, because we can just enable them and we'll be able to get in. So I'm going to go to my trusts, and this time enable my trusts. Great, so all my trusts are enabled. And now I'm going to restart my interface. So it's going to disconnect and reconnect again. There we go. And this time when I go to my message logs and refresh it, I'll see that, yeah, right here. So the connection came in and it was given the user I wanted to, which was Pi Interfaces, that identity. So we now have security access. And we can see on our interface side, all we need to do now is just wait a little bit for the interface to read these text files. And once it reads these text files, it will change the ending of the text file to show that it's been processed, and we'll be able to see the data on the Pi server. Yeah, and now we're seeing UFL process these data files. And we'll actually see, as it reads them, the data is going to be in this window if you wish to watch it. All right. Now, once we've processed the file, we know that it's been successfully processed because it's been given this .ok ending. And we can go to our Pi server and see the data over there. So, to begin with, let's see here. I want to see what's in this data file. And we see that the tag name here is Pi UFL example 1A. So we want to go see if this data made it into the Pi server. Okay. Current values. Pi UFL. Search. Oops, tag mask. We put a wildcard there. Now we can see, oh, we have all these tags. Select all. Oops. Okay. And they each have values. Now I gave them all the same values, so they have similar ones, but we can see here from my Pi server, if I look at my data files, I have this tag. I also have other tags with other names, and they got created on my Pi server. And we can see the final value here matches between 64 and 64 right there. So we know that data is being written to the Pi server. And if we were to actually go look at the history of one of these tags too, we could see it there as well. Pi UFL star. Yeah, and we can see a whole history of data that was written to this tag.